seven, six. Please be seated. Well, welcome for coming this evening. My name is Nikki Salupo, and I am chapter chair of the Fairview Park League of Women Voters. And I am going to, now that you're all seated, would you please stand for the Pledge of Allegiance?
Pledge allegiance to the flag of the United States of America and to the republic for which it stands, one nation, under God, indivisible, with liberty and justice for all.
Thank you. For 96 years, the League of Women Voters has worked on our mission to strengthen our democratic system by increasing the public's participation in the voting process. We are a grassroots organization with more than 800 leagues throughout the United States. Our league is the Greater Cleveland League, made up of chapters represented here: Bay Village, Fairview Park, Rocky River, and Westlake, North Olmsted. We are, as a group, nonpartisan. That is, we do not endorse any candidate, but support citizens' active participation in our democracy through events such as this Candidates Night. Thank you for demonstrating your good citizenship with your attendance. Please continue to exercise and support by voting this fall. Thank you. Now I'd like to introduce our moderator, Janice Patterson. Thank you.
My job is first to tell you about the format and the guidelines, and then I'm primarily a traffic director to get your questions to the candidates with their answers back to you. You should have a blank card that you could write a question on. You can have more than one card to write a question on. If you do not have a card at the moment and would like to have one, raise your hand and our league members around the edges will deliver them to you. And when your answer is, when your question is on it, hold it, your card up and someone will pick it up and bring it to the front of the room. We're doing the Ohio House candidates first as the first set, and then the Ohio Senate candidates. Candidates will have 2 minutes for an opening statement of their choice, and after the question and answer session, the candidates will also have a 2 minute closing. We will have about 30 minutes in each set for questions and answers. I will read the questions off of the card you supplied. The candidates have as much as 2 minutes if they need it for the question, but if they can answer it a little bit more succinctly, we can probably handle more questions. So write short questions, clear questions, readable questions on those cards, and do remember to keep it relevant to the position for which they are a candidate. We do screen the questions for duplication because in a crowd of this size, we will get some crossovers. A lot of you want to know the same things. We will also screen them for appropriateness. And when possible, or it looks like it's feasible, we will combine and make sort of a two-part question, maybe out of something that several people have been wanting to know. The candidates need to know where our timers are. The timers are right here, and they have colorful cards. They will tell you when 1 minute has expired, and when 30 seconds are gone, and then stop. Okay, here we go. Candidates for Ohio House of Representatives, District 16. This position is a two-year position. The winning candidate is eligible for 4 terms, or a total of 8 years, should they choose to run and run and run every 2 years. The salary is $60,584 a year, and there's no per diem. That's a question that often comes up. If you look at your programs, you can see that our House district is relatively compact. And I suspect that we have a lot of people here who actually live in that rather compact district. We'll talk about the differences with this when we get to the Senate case. So, we have two candidates. Farthest to my left, Tommy Greene. Next here, David Greenspan. Mr. Greene, opening statement, please.
My name is Tommy Greene, and I'm running for state representative. I'm running for state representative because I believe regular working people need an advocate in Columbus. I believe that because when I was a young boy, my dad lost his job at LTV Steel, and at that point, my family needed someone to go to bat for us. I still remember how scary those times were for my family and countless families around Northeast Ohio. I'll never forget my mom picking me up from school, tears in her eyes, and me realizing as a young boy that things were about to be pretty tough. Right before the mill went under, my dad took me to a Save Our Steel rally. And, you know, that day I didn't think it was going to be a particularly influential moment in my life. I just thought it was cool because I got to go to work with my dad and I got to play hooky from school. But at that rally, there were a handful of people there fighting for my dad, his job, and our future. And some of those people included Senator Sherrod Brown and Congressman Dennis Kucinich and Mayor Jane Campbell. At that point, I realized that public servants can make a real difference in the lives of working people. Those individuals may not have been able to save my dad's job, but they were there fighting for us. I was born in Westlake and I grew up in Bay Village. I attended Bay schools from kindergarten through 12th grade. I played soccer every Saturday at Cahoon Park, and I played my last game at North Olmsted High School. This is my community and this is my hometown. No one will get up every day fighting harder for you in the State House than me. I love this community. I loved growing up here with my four brothers and sisters, and I want that same experience for my family. Today, I'm the head of business development for a small company on Cleveland's near Westside. My role at the company is to make sure that the lights stay on and that we're employing more people because I know how important that is for families today. Now more than at any time in my life, I'm absolutely confident that Cleveland and Northeast Ohio's best days lie ahead, and I think it's my job to go to Columbus to make sure that that is a reality for all of you. Thank you so much.
For hosting this event tonight. I've been a League member for a few years. And I just want to welcome everybody to the library here in Westlake. We have phenomenal communities over here. A little bit about myself. I do live here in Westlake. My wife and I are raising our three children, although one of them is 23 years old. She just graduated from Kent State University in May, and she's living in New York, living her dream of living in Brooklyn and working in Manhattan in fashion. I have a 21-year-old son who actually yesterday took the Air Force officer qualifying test. It's his intent to serve 20 years in the Air Force as an officer, and we look forward to that a year from May at his commissioning. And I have a 5-year-old who is at St. Raphael's, and his biggest concern right now is looking forward to Halloween and how many different types of candy and what he'll wear for Halloween. Professionally, I've served as the chief financial officer of a few companies, two of which we took public. I've also been chief operating officer of the PGA Tour Radio Network and have served as chief executive officer of a few small companies. And I say that to bring relevance to the fact of understanding that the business cycle is important when you're understanding how to operate in a government environment. And the reason that's important is my political experience. I've been involved and have been fortunate to serve as your county council member here in the same district that I'm running for at the House, the first district of Cuyahoga County Council, which is Bay Village, Fairview Park, North Olmsted, Rocky River, and Westlake. And I have for the last 6 years since we started this new government. But I've also served at the municipal level as a city councilman back in a suburb of Georgia, a suburb of Atlanta called Sandy Springs. And we too there were a new city. We started from scratch, a city of nearly 100,000 people. And that's relevant because here in Cuyahoga County, we started over with our new government a few years ago. And it was with the help of the League that really was instrumental in us crafting our ethics ordinance, our Inspector General ordinance, and as many of you know, Linda Mayer was instrumental in helping that, a fellow League member, helping us move the county along. I look forward to representing you in Columbus with the same vigor and same ethics of morals and same aptitude that I've represented you here in the county council for the last 6 years. Thank you.
While we're waiting for some questions to get assembled here, I'm going to do some reminders, and I, depending on time, I will remind you again of these things at the end of the evening. These are dates. Tuesday, October 11th, the last day to register or to change your name or address. And a little caveat, if you were planning to do it at a city hall or a library on the very last moment, those offices are going to be closed on the Monday, so that's Columbus Day. So get that done beforehand. We have absent mail-in ballot applications out on the literature table. If you don't have one of those, pick one of those up. There will be early voting at the Board of Elections office in downtown Cleveland on Euclid Avenue, and that begins on October 21, and we have a full schedule that we can, if you need to know more detail about that, if I have time, I'll do it, or you can see me afterwards. And then Saturday, November 5th, by noon, is the deadline for getting an mail-in ballot, completed ballot, the application deadline is that noon. Believe it or not, they somehow can turn it around and get you a ballot, because you have to have those ballots back to the Board of Elections before the polls close. So there's key dates there, and they're going to come fast, so take it, do it early. All right, we have a question. Do you support congressional districting reform for Ohio? Mr. Greene.
Thank you. In Ohio, Republicans currently have 65 seats to the Democrats, 34 in the House. And of the 33 Senate seats, the Republicans have a 23-10 majority. That's not conducive for getting things done in Columbus. Right here in the 16th House District, my opponent has a built-in two-point advantage because of the way that the lines were drawn. And this is one of the most fair districts in the state of Ohio. I support expanding our fair districting efforts to Ohio's congressional districts. Ohio's vote totals reflect a 50-50 state, and yet our congressional delegation is 75% Republican to 25% Democrat. The current map splits counties, cities, and townships, and it's drawn for one party's control. We can do better, and I'm looking forward to being a leading voice in making sure that all districts are drawn in a fair way.
Well, I support the referendum or the measure that was passed last year, which does set forward a bipartisan body to draw the districts. I think it's important to understand that when you look at how the districts are drawn, especially at the congressional level, you really start with drawing the majority-minority districts first, and then you work out from there. Now, that's no excuse for the way some of the districts are drawn, and there clearly needs to be some reform so the districts more fairly represent the residents of and the population of the state. So the question is, do I support the congressional redistricting format? And the answer to that question is yes.
Second question has to do with the money, the state money, the school district monies, the money that goes to charter schools. Where do you stand on those tax dollars going to charter schools? Mr. Greenspan.
Thank you. As far as charter schools are concerned, I am not a supporter of for-profit charter schools. I am a supporter of school choice, as I am a supporter of school vouchers, and I believe that that competition is healthy, competition is good, and as long as we provide for an opportunity for the dollars that our taxpayers pay for their students, for their children to go to school, should follow the choice of that family and of that district. I realize that causes some problems and some folks have some challenges with that. I welcome those discussions, but at the end of the day, the objective is to provide the most competent, qualified educational process. And if that involves that our students are in an ability to attend charter schools, if that means that that vouchers follow the student, then that's my position. I believe that we will be able to provide a high quality educational environment by so doing. Thank you.
Yeah, well, this is an area where I disagree with my opponent. I think the vast majority of charter schools in the state of Ohio are failing our kids. Now, the legislature's taken, the reforms passed by the legislature this past year are a good first step, but they don't go far enough. Specifically, for-profit online charter schools need more accountability and transparency. Just this summer, the CEO of ECOT, which is the Electronic Classroom of Tomorrow, said that if they had to release their attendance records, it would, quote, force us and other e-schools to close our doors altogether. Now in Bay Village, so let's take this. Bay Village, $100,000. Rocky River, $269,000. Westlake, $585,000. Fairview Park, $324,000. North Olmsted, $755,000. That's how much money of your tax dollars is going to failing charter schools. That money should be going to our public schools. It should be helping our kids here. This borders on robbery. And frankly, we need a new watchdog in Columbus to crack down on charter schools in Ohio.
This is the first of what are likely to be a lot of related questions. Considering if you were in a position as a state representative, what kinds of viewpoints do you have about local controls related to guns? Mr.
Greene. I support the Second Amendment, and I have no qualms with responsible gun owners, so I want to get that clear from the beginning. But my best friend is a first grade teacher at Normandy Elementary School in Bay Village, and my mom in the audience right now is a teacher's aide at Bay Middle School. If anything were to happen in one of those classrooms, I would feel responsible. I would have to look at all of those parents in the eyes and say, I did nothing to try to stop that from happening, and I wouldn't be able to live with myself. Ohio is one of 17 states where more people die from gun violence than from automobile accidents. That's why I support universal background checks on all gun sales in the state of Ohio. I do not support efforts by Republicans in the legislature and politicians in Columbus to allow guns into daycare centers, into airports, or on college campuses. Our focus should be on keeping guns out of the hands of people who want to do harm to our communities. I'm proud to stand with our police officers, and I'm proud to have their endorsement and their support in this race.
That's a great question. It's a very topical question, obviously, as we start looking more across the country as far as what's happening with gun control and gun rights. I am pro-Second Amendment. I have been endorsed by many organizations who believe in the same principles of gun ownership, responsible gun ownership, and I stand by that position. I will say the one position that I differ from the organizations to which have supported me as it relates to gun control and gun issues has to do with alcohol and alcohol consumption and as it relates to gun presence. There's a movement right now, which I don't support, whereby gun possession can be done while you're drinking or at a bar. And I got to tell you, that's one position, having lost a family member to a drunk driving accident, where I've drawn exception to that specific provision. As far as responsible gun ownership, and as far as being able to limit rights of gun owners, I don't support that. I believe that people have the responsibility protected by the Constitution to carry and bear arms, and I support that measure as I have basically my entire life, especially as a carry and conceal owner and weapons owner, as well as someone who's a member of the NRA. Thank you.
A change of topic. Mr. Greenspan will be the first responder. What is your position on voter identification, given that the state has made many rule changes on this in recent time? What's likely to happen in the next 2 years, and how would you react if you were there?
Well, the current voter identification laws are in place, basically just fall short of requiring a picture ID to vote. You can show up with a utility bill, with a bank statement, with a picture ID. All those methods are sufficient. I would, though, and one of the items, and I've got a list of items that I'd like to address, one of the items that I'd like to add to the list, and I mentioned just earlier that I was a CCW member, is to allow your carry conceal permit to be used as a valid form of ID. Right now, it is not permissible to be able to use that as a permissible form of ID. I am comfortable with the laws of the state of Ohio as it relates to the current identification required to vote, and would prefer that we continue along the same current practices. Thank you.
Mr. Greene?
0.002%. That was the percent of voter fraud in 2012. Voter fraud is not the epidemic that politicians in Columbus and my opponent would have you believe. But Republicans in Columbus are trying to fraud many people out of the right to vote. From trying to stop young Ohioans from voting in primaries to trying to stop the poorest among us from voting through strict voter ID laws, politicians in Columbus are trying to pick who gets to vote instead of us getting to pick who represents them. I'll support all efforts to increase accessibility to the ballot, and I support State Representative Kathleen Clyde's effort to create automatic voter registration in Ohio now. I also support restoring early voting hours, including on evenings and on weekends, so that everyone has the right to vote.
Cuyahoga County will have 2 weekends in which Saturday and Sunday voting is possible. And I don't see evening hours seem to run to 6 p.m. on the second week of early voting. Question, starting with Mr. Greene. Are you willing to pass the laws necessary to fund programs that would end the heroin crisis?
Yes. Look, my family owns 2 funeral homes, one in Westlake and one in Lakewood. The amount of families that have come to us because they've lost a loved one to addiction is on the rise. And one funeral that results from heroin is one too many. And the victims are young and old, rich and poor. This epidemic touches families of every background. That's why I'm supportive of efforts to equip all of our first responders with naloxone, a life-saving drug that can stop an overdose. I'm supportive of giving our teachers and administrators more tools and training to warn students about the damaging effects of heroin and other opioids. I'm supportive of working with our doctors and hospitals to continue to help slow the overprescription of addictive painkillers and for more state funding to support substance abuse and rehabilitation centers across the state.
This is a very interesting and also a very topical subject, and those who've heard me speak before talk specifically about my desire to get engaged and really address this heroin and opioid addiction issue. You know, our state has made tremendous strides in our economy and as far as moving things down the road to provide opportunities for all levels of employment, from middle class workers all the way through to entry level positions. But what we're finding now is that the issue in our state is not so much the skills gap and the qualifications of employers to find employees, it's the competency of these employees being able to pass a drug test. We've got employers that I've spoken to and said, you know what, if you just come to do 2 things as an employee, come to work on time and pass a drug test, we'll train you. That's a sad commentary in Ohio. We need to be very proactive, and I'm honored that this year I was recognized by the Adams Board of Cuyahoga County as being Legislator of the Year. For as Chair of the Finance Committee, we were able to restore funding to the Adams Board to address and deal with this issue, because it is growing. Just this past Saturday in Cuyahoga County alone, we lost 7 people to the heroin issue. We, 2 months ago, I sit on the Board of Control, which is a board that meets weekly to review funding for county operations. We had to additionally fund medical examiner's office, $143,000, for the company that picks up people who have died and passed away from heroin addiction. That's a sad commentary in our society, and we need to work very, very diligently to address this issue. One of the ways we're going to be able to address this issue, and you have to look at this from a practical perspective, is we need to work collectively as a state, with our counties, with our local boards, and Adams Board is an example, but also with agencies that deal with heroin and addiction, to get them to coalesce and collaborate together. Because there are limited resources. There are limited human resources, and there are limited financial resources. The way to address this issue is to foster collaboration between existing groups to address this issue. And for me, this is the number one issue that I see facing our state as we continue to move our state forward, both on an economic perspective, but from a human perspective, in dealing with our families and our communities. And so for this, yes, this is a top priority for me as a platform running for the State House.
As candidates, whichever one of you wins, you will be newcomers in the House, where there have already been a number of bills passed that in this questioner's opinion, have chipped away at women's access to health care. What could you do as these bills are in process, are introduced in other types? What do you believe you can do to consider this matter?
Well, you know, it's very important you can look at someone's record when they have a record to understand where they stand on various women's issues and health issues. And that's something we've done here in Cuyahoga County. We've taken a very proactive stand in providing assistance to women and women's related women's health issues. And so my record is clear. I have a record of supporting these issues and initiatives. And there's no reason to believe that my position and my voting record and what we've done here in the county to advance women's health issues, particularly in the inner city, which is where Cuyahoga County has focused a lot of our efforts in assisting women and young girls in reaching obtaining health care access. So I'll continue to focus on the same focus I've had for the last 6 years, and not only in Cuyahoga County, but as a representative in the State House.
So my opponent didn't answer the question, okay? He's going to go down to Columbus and he's going to vote for a Republican leader to be Speaker of the House of Representatives, and they're the ones bringing to the floor vote after vote, which is chipping away at women's health in the state of Ohio. I'm a proud supporter of a woman's right to make the health care decisions that are best for her. Those decisions should be made between a patient and her doctor. And frankly, politicians in Columbus have no business making those decisions. I'm a strong supporter of organizations like Planned Parenthood, a healthcare organization that provides life-saving treatment like cervical exams, breast exams, and HIV screenings to thousands of patients around Ohio. It's important to remember that for many Ohioans, clinics like Planned Parenthood are their source for primary care. I find the attacks on women's health in Columbus to be offensive, and I will do everything I can to stop them, bill after bill, in their track when I'm your state representative.
There are a lot of elected officials at a lot of levels that work on school issues. Testing is a hot button topic, and especially since those report cards for the different school districts have just come out. As a state representative in this mix of many elected officials, what would you do, or what do you think is the right role for the General Assembly?
I think the testing in our schools is out of control. And I think our local school districts need much more local control over how we're testing our kids. We got some of the best schools here in the state of Ohio, and I absolutely think that our teachers, our principals, our administrators, our school boards, our superintendents are more than capable to make those decisions. But what I view my role as your state representative is the best thing that I can do is make sure that my local schools are getting the funding that they need. The fact is that our schools aren't being adequately funded right now. Under the Republican leadership in Columbus, our schools are getting cut. Westlake schools, where we are right now, Westlake has had over $15 million in cuts over the last 10 years. My kids in Westlake have an additional $1.2 million in cuts right now. In this biennium budget, my kids in Rocky River were cut by over $400,000 a year, and in this budget, my kids in North Olmsted were cut by over $153,000. At the same time that we were cutting education, we were giving another tax break to the wealthiest earners among us. Now, I think that's wrong. I think if we have so much money in state government that our kids certainly shouldn't be the first ones on the chopping block. I believe my first job as state representative is to ensure that every child in the 16th House District gets the best education possible. No one will be a more aggressive champion for our schools during the budgeting process than me. I grew up here, I went to school here, and I know how important our schools are to our communities.
The question was revolving around school testing, correct? So drawing back to the question of school testing, I'll tell you straight up, I'm not a fan of Common Core, not a supporter of Common Core. I do believe that there should be state testing standards. But I believe that the state should push those opportunities of how to teach children back to the local school districts, as should the funding be directed back towards the local school districts. Look, I've got three children. They all learn at different levels. Every school district in the state learns at different levels. The children who live in Cleveland, curriculum very well may be the same as Westlake and Bay Village and Fairview Park, North Olmsted and Rocky River, but they learn differently. They learn differently because their environmental situations that those children are exposed to that our children aren't. We deal in our inner cities with children dealing with food insecurity issues. Who's home when they come home, if anybody's home at all? Do they have someplace warm to sleep at night? Our children out here don't worry about those issues as much as they do in the inner cities. We have to recognize the fact that learning is individual. Learning is not done comprehensively. Common Core is a comprehensive approach to education. It does not work. It will not work. So my best decision, my best answer to your question regarding school testing is we should set a standard to which all of our students should strive towards. We should let the teachers teach the students at the individual school district level and the individual classroom level, and the state should provide the funding to make that happen.
I'm going to follow up a little bit on that. Who is the we that should set the standards? Is it in the General Assembly, or is it someplace else?
Now, look, we're all products of who we are and our backgrounds and our own experiences. Those decisions, those recommendations need to come from the educators themselves to tell us as legislators exactly what they need to be successful in the classroom. And that's exactly what I've done. We talk about representation, we talk about experience and exposure. I've represented this district for 6 years, nearly 6 years. I've had 36 town hall meetings. Those meetings have been designed to engage the community to understand issues that are important to them. And I bring leaders and community leaders in specific topics to talk about those issues, to get feedback, to take back, to be an effective representative. If you look at what being a representative is, it's a voice of the people to whom you represent. It's a voice of the state of Ohio as it relates to the state representative seat. The decisions need to be done in collaboration with the educators, with those people who are on the ground making the hard decisions, living the day-to-day situations, so that they have the tools necessary. Look, I've always said this as I've been an employer and to my employees. At the end of the day, my job is to provide you, meaning my employees, and in this case, we're talking about education, the educators, the tools and the environment they need to be successful. The way you learn what the tools and the environment are needed for them to be successful is by listening to them. And that is something I've done for the last 6 years here in Cuyahoga County, and it's something I continue and plan on doing at the State House.
Mr. Greene, would you like to comment further?
Sure. Look, I spent all of last Friday at Fairview High School, and I was talking to every senior class, all of the juniors at Fairview High School in their AP government classes and their regular government classes, and we talked about a whole range of issues. And one of the things that I asked them about was the over-testing, and I was listening to kids talking about the park testing, which was a failure last year, and how stressed they are, and how our teachers are teaching to the test, and there's no joy anymore in teaching because everyone's freaking out over these standardized tests that are putting way too much pressure on our kids and our teachers. And so I think that those decisions should be brought back to the local level. Like I said in my last question, I think those decisions are best made by our local school boards, our administrators, our teachers. But I've been having these conversations with teachers from Bay High School. I've been having these conversations with teachers from Westlake High School. I've been having these conversations with elementary schools from Bay and Rocky River. And the conversation's not going to end anytime soon.
We're on education for a minute. Let's take another angle. What would you do in your position as a state representative to help school districts get funding cuts restored?
Well, I mentioned this in the last answer. Look, our schools under the Republican leadership in Columbus, our current Republican senator, our current Republican representative, and as far as I can tell, there's no difference between what Dave is going to do from what our current representative is going to do. Our schools are being cut left and right. In this community where we are right now, Westlake has had over $15 million in cuts over the last 10 years. They're experiencing an additional $1.2 million in cuts. In the community that I live in Rocky River, my kids were cut by over $400,000 in this biennium budget. My kids in North Olmsted, where my dad is a soccer coach, those kids were cut by over $153,000 in this biennium budget. How are we expecting our kids to succeed, and how are we expecting our teachers to prepare them for the future when budget in and budget out under the Republican leadership in Columbus, our kids are the first ones on the chopping block? I went to school in this district. I went to Bay schools from kindergarten through 12th grade. I understand better than almost anyone how important these schools are to these communities. And I can promise you that there will not be anyone more aggressive in the budgeting process who will bring those dollars back home than me.
It's a great question. We have obviously have seen issues here, not only in Northeast Ohio, but throughout the state where funding, where the budget's been an issue. Managing the budget has been a challenge. What I can tell you on two issues that I've taken a position on is holding harmless the funding for local government funding as well as school funding. So if you lay down the parameters of going down to Columbus and saying, listen, here's what we need to do. We need to make sure that our cities and our townships and our villages are secure in their funding source, and we need to do the same thing with our schools. Here's where the difference comes in. I chair our county finance and budgeting committee. All right, our budget is a $3 billion biennial budget. When we sat down with our budget, we had a change of philosophy with the new executive. We had to make hard decisions. We had to make value decisions. What is it that we want to do? What is it that we want to be as a county? And how is it that we can financially support those issues? So we sat down and we prioritized. We prioritized with our seniors. We prioritized with health and human services. And we sat down and set those goals. And they're hard decisions. And it's not easy. But if you understand the needs and the desires and opportunities and challenges within your communities, as experience has taught me over the last 6 years, you find ways to sit down and make those challenges and those opportunities become realities. But I can tell you that the two positions that I'm firm on is holding harmless at any funding reductions for the local government fund as well as school funding. And as also serving on the board of the County Commissioners of Association Board of Directors for the last 2 years, I've been exposed to challenges across the state that we don't deal with here in Cuyahoga County, because we don't deal with a lot of the rural issues. We don't deal with a lot of the agricultural issues. We have many challenges in the state. It's important to elect somebody who has the experience and exposure, who's been there, has made those tough budget decisions, who's held steadfast beliefs and ideals for the best interest of the residents of the state, and more particularly and recently in my experience, the county.
Can we stay on this issue? Because I think this is important, and this is an area where we truly have differing opinions on.
I think we will hit a couple other topics, okay. And then we'll come back.
Okay.
This one has to do with Lake Erie, primarily. So, Mr. Greenspan, what could you do as a state representative to make sure that sufficient protections are in place to keep Lake Erie clean?
Well, as we know, last year, the Senate and the House, the governor signed Senate Bill 1, which is a compact to ensure that Lake Erie has the sufficient resources to start rejuvenating itself and cleaning itself up. I believe we need to be respectful to the legislation that was passed and give it some time to make sure that it actually works, that the legislation that was put in place, the restrictions and the guidance that was put there, have an opportunity. You know, oftentimes folks get down in a legislative role, whether it's a city or a county or whether it's at a state level, and they come in with these great ideas, and before you know it, ideas that were passed in the previous legislative session or the past year never have an opportunity to go to fruition because they're changed immediately because somebody else comes in with a different ideal. What I think we need to do here is respect what was done in the legislature as it relates to Senate Bill 1. Let's see how and monitor the progress of the efforts as a result of the items outlined in that bill, and take a look and see the impact, but be mindful that if things don't work, we need to respond very quickly and be responsive to those needs. And look, I'm an avid fly fisherman, so I'm not necessarily on Lake Erie in particular, because you don't necessarily fly fish on Lake Erie, but you fly fish in the tributaries, and I have a vested interest to ensure for my own personal recreation that Lake Erie is successful. You know, and that we look at it not only as a resource as it relates to recreation, but we look at it as a resource for commerce, and as we look at it as a resource for us to continue to develop the region. Because one of the things that you're going to hear is that, and we see this now, but we're going to start to realize it more readily with the states down in Arizona and Nevada and California. They're in critical water shortages. Our lake right now is one of our greatest assets as it relates not only to recreation but to being an economic development driver. Because in the next few years, we're going to start to realize that these businesses that rely on water are going to be desiring to move to Northeast Ohio or to Ohio in general as it relates to be able to meet their objectives. This goes back to kind of a holistic approach looking at how we deal with our economy and strengthening our economy. It ties back into heroin. We got to make sure we've got a workforce. It ties back into education, infrastructure, utilities, and I would consider this as one of the valuable resources we need to address.
Sure, well, with all due deference to my opponent, there is no time to wait on this issue. Lake Erie is suffocating. There were over 400,000 residents in Toledo who went without clean drinking water. That is embarrassing in 2016. Now, one of the best parts of growing up in the 16th House District is growing up on the lake. And I've spent countless hours, whether that was at Huntington Beach, or paddleboarding or kayaking on the Rocky River, the water is home to me. And that's why this issue is personal. While we've made some progress on this issue, there's still plenty to do, and Lake Erie needs a new watchdog down in Columbus. We still need common sense regulations on farming practices and on the storage, use, and application of fertilizers. We need more investments in infrastructure projects to help water runoff. And we need leaders in Columbus who will bring Republicans and Democrats, Northern Ohioans and Southern Ohioans, rural Ohioans and urban Ohioans together to solve this issue. Because clean drinking water is something that we all need. I believe Lake Erie will be an economic engine that allows Northeast Ohio to thrive for decades to come, but that can only be a reality if we protect Lake Erie today.
Another topic that's come in on more than one card, it's a sort of a two-part question, if you can do it in 2 minutes, do your best shot. Do you support the right of unions to organize, and what, if any, changes would you propose for public and private unions?
Yes, I support a union. I'm a proud son of a former steel worker, and I wouldn't change any laws. I would make no changes to the laws on the books when it comes to both private and public and private sector unions. I am against right to work, and so this is an easy question for me. I wouldn't make any changes to our current laws on the books as it pertains to regular working people, because you know I grew up in a regular working family here in Bay Village. My dad was a steel worker. My parents are in the room. I'm gonna give a quick shout out to my mom and dad. Look, I had one of the best childhoods growing up in Bay. The answer to everything was yes. Yeah, you can do band. Yes, you can do choir. Yes, you can play soccer. Yes, you can play basketball. Yes, we'll go on the trip to Disney with the band. Yes, we'll go to New York and Chicago with the choir. Yes, we can go to soccer tournaments all over the country. And the reason that was a reality was because my dad had a good union paying job. And so when I see Republicans in Columbus try to pass things like Senate Bill 5, or they introduce bills like right to work, I find that offensive because those are attacks on my family. Now, my opponent had an opportunity in 2010 when Senate Bill 5 came up, or 2011, excuse me, there was a resolution on county council that he could have voted to say that Senate Bill 5 was wrong, and he was one of, I believe, two or three votes on council where he didn't stand on the side of working people. And so I think my record in terms of labor unions and working people speaks for itself, and I think my opponent has a long record of being not for unions.
Thank you. You know, it's a challenging opportunity here because I've listened to my opponent make various accusations and statements against me, and yet he has never addressed me and asked me these questions. The resolution he's talking to, he actually is 100% incorrect. I actually did support the resolution and wrote the governor a letter letting him know that I did not support Senate Bill 5 because of its inclusion of public safety. So what I will do in respect to my opponent is I will forward him a copy of that resolution, and I will make it available to League of Women Voters to put on their website. Now, as it relates to union organization, I am not for right to work. I've had over a dozen unions support my candidacy, so I believe that the answer to the question speaks for itself by the support that I've received and by my voting record. So I will provide to the League of Women Voters that resolution, which has my vote on it.
Thank you. One more take on the funding of the schools issue before we go to your closing statements. Just a quick, let's do a minute and a half, what you would like to say about school funding as a sort of a parting shot at this event.
Sure, I'll defer to my phone. He's always made a request for additional funds. Okay. I thought the rules were that we were going to alternate who asked questions first. Which I defer. Okay.
Look, I sound like a broken record when it comes to school funding, but that's because I talk to teachers and parents and administrators and school board members every week, and they tell me, Tommy, the best thing that you can do for our schools is to get down to Columbus and in the budgeting process as you could bring those dollars back home. I'm going to repeat this. In this community where we're sitting right now, under the Republican leadership in Columbus, this school district has been cut by over $15 million over the last 10 years. They're experiencing an additional $1.2 million in cuts. That is unacceptable. Our children should not be the first on the chopping block. In my community where I live in Rocky River, my kids were cut by over $400,000 in this biennium budget. That is unacceptable. Those kids should not be on the chopping block. In North Olmsted, where my dad is a soccer coach, those kids were cut by over $153,000 in this biennium budget. That is unacceptable. Our kids should not be the first ones on the chopping block. Those days are over as soon as I am your state representative.
All right, we are ready to move to our closing statements from our House of Representative candidates. Mr. Greene will have the first 2 minutes for closing. I will tell you that we've had questions here on a number of topics we haven't been able to cover, but I still see many questions about how, what your qualifications are for the position. And we've had questions about manufacturing, how we can bring more jobs to Ohio, more on unions, others here. So you probably have a prepared statement. If you care to make it, go ahead, but reflect back on what you most wanted to say to the audience. Let's see.
Well, I want to thank the League of Women Voters for having me. I want to thank everyone here in the audience for coming out tonight to learn a little bit more about myself and my opponent, Dave. Thank you for being here with me. I want to thank my parents who are in the room, Tom and Denise Green. Thank you guys for helping to make me the man that I am today. I love you guys so much. And my aunt and uncle are here, two aunts and uncles in here, some of my grandparents as well. Look, I am from this community. When I graduated college, I went to Washington, D.C., and I came back to Ohio. I could have lived anywhere. I have friends that live in New York, California, Colorado, Texas. But I came back to the west side of Cleveland because I wanted to make a difference for you. You know, growing up in Bay Village is a very special place. You know, Friday night football, your Westlake is your rival, Rocky River is your rival, North Olmsted is your rival. Being in the band and the choir, you know, my life experience is so special. And I want that same experience for kids in this district and for all of you for years to come. And so my pledge to you is I'm gonna wake up every day. I'm going to bust my butt for the working people of the 16th House District when I'm elected. You can always call me, you can always email me. I'll never turn you away. I'm always gonna tell you the truth. But this is my community. This is where I grew up. And I'm absolutely confident that our best days are ahead, and I can't wait to serve all of you in the legislature. Thank you for having me today.
Mr. Greene. I appreciate everyone being here. Once again, I want to thank the League and Ms. Patterson for hosting tonight. You know, these are important times we live in. And these are job interviews. When you're electing individuals, you're electing people to represent you in the state of Ohio. And what we're looking for when we look to hire individuals is we look for people with the right experience, people who have been there, who understand the challenges, who have the right experience and exposure to make the right decisions on your behalf. I've had the good fortune of representing you for the last 6 years as your county council member. I enjoy the opportunity and the challenges to represent you. I believe I understand what the opportunities are here, what the opportunities are in the state because of my exposure and serving on the County Commissioners Association Board. And I believe it's important to understand and look back and reflect upon someone's experience when considering them to represent you in the future. You know, we live in a very unique county, and I've been fortunate to serve on the county council, as I've mentioned before. We have a county council made up of 11 members. 8 Democrats and 3 Republicans. We've put party partisanship aside. You won't hear me make an attack against a Republican or a Democrat. I may challenge an ideal. Because that's how our government here in Cuyahoga County has been able to succeed and take us from a period of corruption to periods of prosperity. We've worked hard. Where else would you see a Republican as myself chair a finance committee in a county where the council president is a Democrat and the other seven members of council are Democrats? You won't see that anywhere else. I challenge you to look anywhere in the country to find that. We're fortunate because we set those ideological party issues aside. We don't agree with one another. We may not agree in this room on certain issues, but one thing you can count on me based on my experience, my exposure, my history, is I have always represented you fairly and equitably. I've always put the best interests of this district first, and it's my intent to continue to do the same thing as your representative in Columbus. I hope that I can earn your vote on November 8th, and I thank everyone once again for showing up and participating in this process. Thank you.
Would Mr. Dolan and Ms. Hagan please come forward? All right, get your cards ready, and it's all right to ask all the same kinds of questions because most of those issues are going to hit senators just like representatives. The Ohio Senate District 24 is the area that we're considering. Look on your map at how the Senate district is formed. These candidates have surely added a lot of mileage in the last few months here. The Senate term is a four-year term. There's a two-term limit, and the salary is $67,545, and senators do not receive a per diem, just as the case with the representatives. So we will begin our opening remarks with Matt Dolan. Mr. Dolan.
Thank you, Janice. Thank you. Good evening. Thank you for your patience. Thank you to the League, and thank you to John Carroll for taking the time to come out today and learn about our process. I'm Matt Dolan. I'm running for state senator. You know, all of us, when you run, you're always asked, you know, why do you want to do that job? And the answer is just easy for me. I really like working on public policy. I want to bring my years of experience both in the state house. I served in 2005, 2010. Been 27 years of practicing attorney, both started in the attorney general's office, prosecutor's office, and then private practice, and have been involved in a number of private businesses throughout the Northeastern Ohio. And the culmination of that experience allows me to go to Columbus on your behalf and focus on a number of things. But for the sake of tonight, we got to make sure that Ohio is a place for economic prosperity and economic growth. And to do that, I can make sure that the fixed costs of business, as a government official, I can work with private sector and say, those costs that you pay before you even open your doors in the morning, lower taxes, less regulations, keep utilities costs down, workers' comp, unemployment, all the things that will allow you, the individual, to go out and sell your goods and services so that you can be successful and create jobs. We do need an education revolution. We can't have a one-size-fits-all. Our students have to be ready for college. They got to be ready for an associate degree or vocational degree, or they got to be ready to be employed. And we can't have a one-size-fits-all public education policy if we're going to achieve those goals. And I am a big proponent, and have always been a big proponent of Lake Erie. I have authored the Great Lakes Compact, which simply said, along with the other Great Lakes states, we said, if you want our water, you're coming here, because it's not just fishing, it's not just tourism, it is a tool for economic development. I live in Chagrin Falls with my wife, Jessica. We have my son, Sam, who's 15, my stepson, Maddox, who's 14. And one personal note that my son tonight got called up to varsity at Chagrin Falls, so he's 55 minutes into his first varsity game. And I'm dying to read my phone to find out how he's doing very well.
Thank you. Thank you for the League of Women Voters. I really appreciate the work you do to educate and engage voters. and I look forward to this discussion tonight. So I'm running because I'm concerned about the direction Ohio is headed. I'm concerned about attacks that women have had on their healthcare decisions. I'm concerned about workers' attacks, and I'm concerned about attacks that public schools have had. I think I'm the best candidate to address these issues because I'm experienced. I've worked at two different nonprofits. One was Voices for Ohio's Children, where we worked for juvenile justice reform. The other was Center for Community Solutions, where we worked for early childhood education, funding, and awareness. And during that time, I would go to the legislature and lobby for funds and awareness. I have knowledge of the community and I represent the community. My husband and I are both full-time workers. We both have big student loans that we're working to pay back. We have two young sons. They go to public school in Rocky River. One's in second grade and the other is in kindergarten. I can bring a voice to the legislature that is most overlooked in our current climate. One thing I would like to point out is that right now in the Senate, out of 33 members, only 7 of them are women. We're grossly underrepresented and, as a result, misrepresented in the Senate. I also have experience having people reach middle ground. So I work for Judge Donnelly in the Court of Common Pleas, and part of my job is to mediate cases. Many times parties come in and they're evaluating their cases at very different levels. My job is to bridge that gap and to have them compromise and work together to come to a solution. One other thing I'd like to say is that I have stamina. I would answering Mr. Trump's question. So with that, I respectfully ask for your vote. Thank you.
All right, now we'll go to our questions and answers. The first question to Mr. Dolan first. What is your position on whether or not public employees, such as teachers, police, and firemen, should be allowed to strike in Ohio?
Thank you. Public employees, so right now in Ohio, police and fire can't strike. So I wouldn't change that in the law. I do think that as far as the teachers unions go, we got to recognize that they have equally as important a responsibility to our students as our police and fire do to our safety. So while Senate Bill 5 was an overreach, there were some issues in there where I fully agreed, and that is the ability for a non-binding arbitration so that if there's a dispute between management and teachers, the dispute gets resolved and the student's education is not disrupted.
So I believe in collective bargaining. I believe in the right to strike. I believe that workers need to have rights to enable them to have a voice, right? So what collective bargaining means is that it's bargaining. It's not giving one party an advantage over the other. Every party is coming to the table and working together to come to a solution. If that can't happen, the choice to strike needs to be there because that's another leverage that they can use. And so that is my position. And I've been endorsed by many, many labor unions because of my strong belief in labor.
Combining some questions here that are popping up about energy, Mr. Dolan, the question is related to restoring initiatives for alternative energy in Ohio, and it's sort of a sidebar, but perhaps somewhat related. What about wind turbines in Lake Erie?
Okay, so when I was in the legislature, I voted for the bill, the energy bill that put in the alternative energy standards that required a certain percentage of energy being produced by various methods of alternative energy. I supported it because we need to create, look at alternative energy as an economic engine. And the only way you're going to have it be an economic engine if we create the market. Now, since I left, those standards got pulled out, and there's a question now before the legislature whether they do it before either I or Emily gets there, whether they're going to touch that bill. This is an easy one for me. We go back and we put it in at 12.5% for 3 years. Then in year 4 and 5, I would raise it up to 18 or 22%. The reason I would do it 5 years is because, as you learned, our term is 4 years. And in order to get away from this transactional method of legislation, we got to have pieces of legislation that last longer than the terms of the legislature, so that we can stand before you and decide whether it's working or not, and not have any knee-jerk reactions. As to the windmill on Lake Erie, if they want to do it, great, but I'd be very reluctant to provide any further money, because technology is far past that along. When that first started, they were going to put wind turbines out 5 miles out of the lake. They have to bring all the energy back. That's a lot of money. Now, you can get a turbine for your building. It used to be that you could only take straight line winds. Now you can handle intermittent winds. And those intermittent winds are all downtown. So you can put a turbine on your building. We did that down at Progressive Field. We put one right on our building to take in that wind. So we don't need to have these huge projects. I'm not saying you shouldn't do it. It's a question of where we allocate taxpayers' money to be the most efficient and effective in attracting alternative energy, not just for its use, but mainly for its economic development and job creation.
Okay, so I believe in green energy. It's the right thing to do. It's the future. It will create jobs. It's good for our environment, and it will make Ohio industry more competitive. You know, Ohio ranks in the top 5 states for its technical potential to deploy power technology, but it's only 42nd in adoption of that technology. So we're lagging behind, and we absolutely need to address that issue.
Ms. Hagan, I let Mr. Dolan go ahead on the last 2 questions, so you can go first on the next 2. This is an issue that sometimes just pops up again and again and again in the General Assembly. What would be your position on repeal of term limits?
So, you know, I go back and forth on term limits. Term limits were created so we wouldn't have career politicians, right? Well, we know that that has not worked. We have a situation where politicians, you know, serve in the Senate, and then they move to the House, and then they move back to the Senate, and then their wife or their son or their daughter takes their place. And so you start seeing those same names again. And, you know, I don't necessarily think that's a bad thing, because when somebody wants to dedicate their life to a work in public policy and serving others, I think that's a commendable job. On the other hand, you don't want to create a situation where there's voter apathy and somebody thinks, well, you know, we can't beat the person in power because they've been there forever. But that's something that I would have to think about more to create a specific stance on it. But I can say right now, it's not working. Term limits are not working.
So term limits are fine. I think I would extend them a little bit longer to 12 years so that the educational process, and so we get away from less transactional legislation. That is, introducing a bill or voting no or yes on a bill because it helps you campaign for another job 2 or 4 years later. But this is what I would do. I would make sure that you, I don't know if she agrees or disagrees, but I don't like this flip-flopping back and forth. I think that you ought to serve your term. Take 2 years off, and if you want to go back, go back. But I think you owe it to the public to serve your 8 years or 12 years without an eye for just jumping back and forth to the Senate. I can tell you, though, nothing will impact better government than redrawing our lines. And fortunately, in the state, we're going to get it done in 2022. But I'll anticipate the other question, next question, or the question that was asked. Absolutely. We've got to look at how we change our lines, because it's going. You want to start a real dialogue. Make sure that general elections matter. Emily and I are fortunate. We are in a district that could go her way, could go my way. We have to work hard, we have to sell our beliefs, and you get to decide. There are 99 House seats right now. I'm pretty sure I can tell you who's going to win 88 of them. I couldn't tell you the name, but I'll tell you the party. That's wrong. We've got to make it more competitive. Because if you make it more competitive, then ideas win in the end. And when you go to Columbus or you go to Washington and you represent a more fair standard of fair representation of your state, then you have to dialogue. Then you have to talk. And you got to work on all issues on both sides. Yeah, you still can be principled, but you got to represent a fair portion of your constituency.
Another question for Ms. Hagan first. Do you support voter ID changes, and what kind of law changes would you support?
I don't support anything that makes voting harder. I think that, Tommy mentioned earlier today, it was 0.002 or 0.003% of voter fraud. That's a fiction that was created to scare us. There is no worry that people are voting twice or, fixing the vote. That does not happen in Ohio. That's not a concern that we need to worry about. We need to worry about making voting accessible and easy for everybody so everybody's voice can be heard.
I was fortunate enough to serve in the State House in 2000. I started serving in January of 2005. When I got elected in November 2004, guess what? We all voted in one day. That was just in 2004. If you wanted an absentee ballot, you had to have show cause as to why you could have it. We fortunately now in Ohio can vote 28 days before the election day. You can vote 24 hours or 7 days a week. You can vote in your living room. You can vote in your bedroom. You can vote in your bathroom. If you don't want to vote in your house, you can drive down to the County Board of Education, as Janice mentioned, on the weekends. Folks, it is easy to vote in Ohio. It is an absolute privilege to vote in Ohio. Proving who you are is a necessary part of voting. I'm not going to advocate for a picture ID. I think our ID's formula is just fine. But you've got to prove who you are. That's a fundamental nature. You should be proud to say who I am when you walk in there and vote. That is your exercise of a right. So let's not buy into the dialogue. You know, everybody talks about Golden Week and, oh, we lost Golden Week. I was there when Golden Week was put in. I voted for it. Every Democrat voted against it. Now the Democrats are saying, the Republicans took it away from us. Voting is easy in Ohio. Exercise your right and choose the best candidate, but you have 28 days, 24 hours, 7 days a week to make that choice.
This is a good time for me to correct a mistake when I transposed numbers when I told you earlier information. Voting does start on October the 12th, the day after registration closes. And what I was talking about are the voting early voting hours in person at the Board of Elections office. So that's a whole set of hours that's not nearly as compatible perhaps with your life as the 24-hour, 28-day thing that Mr. Dolan has just told us. Okay, another question. I'm sure you were anticipating this. What, as a state senator, could you do, would you do, to help restore funding cuts to local school districts?
Thank you. There's two types of cuts. The cuts that impact in 24th Senate District the most are the cuts in the personal property tax reimbursement plan. That plan went into effect when we eliminated the inventory tax and the personal property tax, which were inhibitors to business growth. But the revenue of those taxes stayed local. They went to your cities and they went to your schools. And so when I was there, we created a TPP, Tangible Personal Property Tax Reimbursement Fund, that was going to extend until 2017 so that budgets in the school systems could go out 5 years and be able to prepare for the next 5 years. Unfortunately, my own party in 2011 severely cut back on the TPP. So the easy thing for me is to go back and fulfill our promise that we made to the school districts and say, look, you agreed with these taxes that are inhibitive of business growth. Let's get your money back. The formula funding was talked about before. The formula funding is based on the state legislature. Now, this last budget, they gave just under $16 billion to education. It's the highest amount ever. The question is the distribution of those dollars. And in our districts, the funding formula, a lot of what goes into that is not impacting our districts. We don't have high rates of poverty. We don't have high rates I'm blanking on a term there. These are monies that go towards more urban districts. So I'm going to try to be political here for one second. You know, for them to say the Republicans did all these bad things, look to where most of the school money goes. It goes into Democratic districts. It goes away from districts like ours. Because our superintendents understand that they'd like to have more money, they want their TPP back, but they also understand that some of the money that's going to these urban districts are for needs and problems that do not exist in our district. Hopefully we can get a question on policy, which I can relate back to the funding.
Okay, so first of all, charter schools take away millions of dollars from our public schools every year. They are failing our children, there's no oversight, and we absolutely need to stop that. I would also like to point out that out of the 10 school levies on the ballot in November, 7 of them are in the 24th Senate District. This is a huge issue, and we need to address it. But again, if you look at the money trail, there are millions of dollars being taken away from our public schools, going to charter schools that are failing our students. We need to fix it, and it's very hard to fix it right now because there are so many politicians in Columbus that are taking money from these charter schools. They are not properly oversighting any of them. So they're letting them run rampant. And it is Ohio has been called a national joke because of these charter schools. We need to fix that.
Let's stay on education a minute, starting with Ms. Hagan. What can you do in your position to help regulate the testing and the state testing and grading? You heard the question before to our representative candidates. We have said that there are a lot of elected officials involved in this matter. What could you do as a senator?
We need to give the power back to the schools and the districts. They know best. They know what works for the kids, the teachers, the administrators. It's their job to figure out how to measure success for their students. It's not the job of people in Columbus who don't know about education to do that.
Well, let me dovetail on that. It's not the people in Columbus, unfortunately, right now. It's the people in Washington that are setting the establishments which people in Columbus have to carry out. So one is we got to get relief from the federal government as to their mandates on us as a state to fulfill these testing requirements. Test requirements are necessary because we got to have standards. We got to have something to measure it by. But our school systems, you know, the best measurement is you, the parents. And you will know whether your son or daughter is getting a quality education. And so we need to be able to allow our school systems to make an application to be exempt from taking the test. Not individually by a parent, but entirely by a district. Because you won't vote for it if your student is not getting a quality education. I just went to curriculum night at my son's school at Chagrin Falls High School, and the biology teacher was walking through what was, you know, extremely exciting curriculum, and then all of a sudden he said, well, now in this time of the school year, we have to stop for 6 weeks, and I have to switch and start teaching to this test that the school will take in April. Then when the test is over, we'll continue on with this curriculum. You know, that's a failure of our school system, our education system, that we can't allow our teachers to teach at a high level or a quality level to fulfill a test. If your school system is not producing at that level, then we do need to have a standard that would make sure that our kids are being educated and that our teachers are teaching, are able to teach quality curriculum. So we do have to get it back from Washington, back into our control, allow the school systems to work with each other, the parents, to decide, do we want to be exempt from these tests, and then rework the test for those school systems that do have it, so that it's properly measuring the quality of education and the standards that we want our child to graduate with from Ohio schools.
Switching a bit to business and business incentives. Starting with Mr. Dolan, what would you do to bring jobs to Ohio and new businesses to the 24th District?
Okay, thank you. So as a state senator, I would hope that I'm providing an environment for you, and perhaps me and my other hat, for bringing jobs to Ohio. It's not the government's responsibility, but it is the government to assist. And as I mentioned in my opening statement, government and private sector can work best is if government is working with you to be able to find out what are the impediments to economic growth. Lower taxes at all levels, not just the state level. You can't pass lower taxes in Columbus and shift the burden up here. That's not good for economic incentive, that's not good for property values, it's not good for a lot of things. So low and fair taxes across the board. Make sure our utility costs are under control. You have competition amongst your utility. That's how you keep those prices going, keep them low. You keep regulations to a point where they're measuring, making sure that's for health and safety, but it's not impeding economic growth. And there's lots of examples there. What I mean is, we've got to create that environment for you to sell your goods, to sell your services. Because I'm a firm believer that you are much better at creating a job. Because if you have growth, because if your numbers are up and your quality's up, you're gonna hire. Because it's your responsibility and your desire to sell more products and sell more services. That's how you create an environment for that. Coupled with that, we need an education system that is meeting your needs as an employer. That as right now in Ohio, there are so many unfilled skilled manufacturers jobs. That's one of the reasons, because our school systems aren't working with our private sector in order to train vocationally these students to be prepared for those jobs. So it is environment creating, it is making sure that the role of government working with the private sector to meet the needs of the private sector so that the environment for growth, for sustained job creation, for economic prosperity is there.
Okay, going back to what we talked about before with green energy, that's a great opportunity to create more jobs in Ohio. That is something that is untapped right now, and we really need to look into that to create more jobs and in turn help the environment. The other thing is we do need an educated workforce, and to do that we need a good education system in Ohio. And again, we really need to look at where the money's going to make sure that our kids are getting educated.
Another topical switch. First answer from Ms. Hagan. As a senator, how would you respond to efforts to make Ohio a right-to-work state?
Thank you. So I would like to point out that maybe not obvious to everybody, but I am pro-union. My dad worked for AFSCME for over 20 years, and I'm a big believer in unions. So right-to-work, I believe, is wrong, and if you look at other states that have enacted right-to-work legislation, their economies aren't doing well, their workers aren't doing well. It's not good for the state, and it's been proven, so I would absolutely fight against it.
I would vote no on a right-to-work, not because I'm beholden to any union group. Right now, it's not right for Ohio. We don't have the political capital to do it. We don't have the economics to do it, and the reality is that with some of the changes that I would hope that we can bring, we'll create the economic growth, we'll create the economic prosperity, and we will have good, skilled, paying jobs. Right now, they're just going unfilled. It's not a result of any public policy. It's a result of we're not having enough skilled workers to meet the demands of our employer.
Mr. Dolan, please answer this one first. As candidates, you are now dealing with Ohio's campaign finance reporting and all the laws that have to do with campaign finance reporting for state candidates. Would you like to see any changes in that?
Well, I would like some changes, but the changes would have to come at the federal level. I believe in complete transparency, that if you are taking money from someone, you have a right to do that. Campaigns are expensive, but you have a right to know who is funding. So you can make a judgment as to whether or not that's going to influence my job as a representative of you. Dead set against my party. I do not like what's happening at the federal level. I hate all these third-party ads, and you don't know who's funding them. I would rather see all the money. If we have to put this much money in the politics, it should go only to the candidate. The candidate should report it, and you guys, or me too, because I'm a voter, can decide whether that person is being bought or sold. But it does everyone a disservice when you have no idea who is running these ads. So Ohio laws are that both of us will have to report here in a couple weeks. You'll be able to go online, it's public, you can see who's funding me, and you can make a decision whether that's influencing me or not influencing me, but you get to, as a voter, get to make that choice. You don't always get to make that choice on a federal level.
So I absolutely believe in transparency. I think we need to take the money out of politics. It's getting to the point where you have to raise so much money to run that it's prohibitive for a lot of people, a lot of really good people, to run a successful campaign. The other issue that we have right now, because the state legislature is so imbalanced, the Republicans have a lot more money than the Democrats. Just because, for instance, lobbyists and all sorts of third-party individuals are funding them because they have the power, and so Democrats are at a distinct disadvantage, and we need to absolutely change that.
We are ready to move now to our closing statements. Mr. Dolan will have the first two-minute closing statement.
Okay, thank you. Nice job moderating. Thank you, everybody, for coming, your time and attention. I know you've been sitting in those seats a long time. But thank you for coming, because it is obviously a great statement on the League of Women Voters that so many people are here, and it's also a great statement individually that you took the time out on a beautiful fall night to come out and listen to us. And so what I'm hoping I can do for you tonight is to give you the opportunity to say that there's someone who stood before you and applied for a job and recognized that my duty to go to Columbus is to work for you, is to advocate on your behalf so that Northeastern Ohio, for the 24th District, for really all of Ohio, is a great place to live, work, and to raise your children. We both have young children, mine a little bit older. But my passion is to make sure that Ohio is a place for them to decide to stay here. We have some John Carroll students here. They're a little further along. They're going to make decisions. Is Cleveland, is Northeastern Ohio, is Westlake a great place to raise? And we've got to make sure that we have that economic climate that I talked about. We have to make sure that we have an education system that prepares kids for their choice of university study, associate degree study, or whether they're ready to hit employment, that we use our natural resources, the lake, and that I represent you in a way that would make you proud. I opened my remarks by saying everybody always asks us, why do you want to do this? Well, my hope is that when Emily's kids and my kids come of age and they decide to either come to a forum like this and sit in the chair, or maybe one of them will sit up here, that the attitude at that point won't be, why are you doing this? The attitude will be, why aren't you doing this? And that starts with me. And so I want to go work hard for you. I want to earn your vote. And I'm hoping in January I can start working for you, not just in the manner of getting things done, but in a manner that makes you proud of who's serving you in Columbus. Thank you for your attention tonight.
Thank you again for this opportunity. Thank you, League of Women Voters. This was a great forum. So I'm running because there is a real need and opportunity to change things in Ohio. My background and experience suits this district and is best fit for the district at this time. So through my experience, I've seen in Columbus how the process works so well when legislators are engaged and willing to compromise and energized. And I've seen how it's failed when legislators are not willing to compromise, not willing to listen. So I think that to do this meaningfully, we need to restore the balance in the legislature. They have a supermajority, and what that means is they don't have to listen to anybody they don't want to. They don't even have to listen to members of their own party when they don't want to. Electing me would mean starting to restore the balance. That's what we need to do. So with that, I respectfully ask for your vote tonight. Thank you.
Very much, candidates, and Mr. Greene and Mr. Greenspan. I also noticed that there have been some other public officials from our region in and out of the room, and I think it's nice to think that they came to see what you're thinking, because it relates to what they do and other levels of government here. Again, pay attention to those deadlines. Get that, if you're going to vote by mail, get that application in. That's a step that many people will find out about too late. And this is preaching to the choir, and I'm not really a preacher, but I know that you all care about your vote. You have contact with how many hundreds of people between now and November 8th? There's a lot of controversy about whether people are going to vote. Look at that ballot. There are so many important down ballot issues. All of these candidate positions, school levies, that's where it really, really can make a difference today, tomorrow, and forever. So help everybody realize that there's something on every ballot for every registered voter to vote for. We hope you'll visit our literature table in the hall. We have a little time that you can talk to candidates here before we have to leave the library. And walk slowly through the library and look at the display, the historical voting display that the League of Women Voters has had in there this month, and well, for, what did we say, 10 more days, something like that. We have an early voting ballot box from Westlake, which is very different from the way we vote now. I think we have some closing remarks from our co-chair from the Westlake North Olmsted chapter.
I want to thank our four candidates for appearing tonight, and especially I want to thank Janice Patterson for doing a phenomenal job. I also want to thank all of our League volunteers who worked on this event, particularly our question screeners and our two timers out here in the front, and our ladies in the back at the information table. I also want to thank Porter Library for providing the use of this lovely space for this forum, and also our videographers. The program from tonight will be available on the Westlake cable channel if you wish to see it again, or if you want to share that information with someone who was not able to be here. I will repeat what Janice said regarding our display in the lobby. On your way out, you will find that in the cases that are next to the gift shop. There are various other display cases in the lobby. And last but not least, I want to thank all of you for coming out tonight. This was a wonderful crowd. Shows democracy in action, I guess we should say. and for your thoughtful questions. So again, thanks to everyone. We'll give you some